Joining us now in the studio for this week's Your Health segment is Dr. Mohammed Siddiqui, assistant professor of surgery at the University of Maryland School of Medicine and urologist at the University of Maryland Medical Center. Doctor, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
September is Prostate Cancer Awareness Month, so let's start by raising a little bit of awareness. This is a very common cancer, especially in older men, right?
Absolutely, yeah. So, I mean, it is the most common cancer in men. And about 230,000 men get prostate cancer in the United States alone. It's the most common cancer amongst men in the United States and in the Western world. About 30,000 men a year actually die of prostate cancer a year.
And it is treatable.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, the outlook is very good for prostate cancer. Cancers have a spectrum of outcomes, but about 90 to 95% of people who are diagnosed with prostate cancer can actually survive it and get cured of it.
In your practice, in your experience, how does it tend to be first diagnosed?
You know, so prostate cancer is interesting in that it's a symptomless disease. And that's actually a recent last 10, 15 year development. It used to be a disease where it presented with symptoms. And back when it was a disease with symptoms, when we couldn't diagnose it with blood tests and routine screening, people didn't do very well because they would come in with very aggressive disease, and the survival was much, much less. But now it's diagnosed by essentially regular visits to your primary care doctor. And the primary care doctor will do things such as a digital rectal exam and get a PSA test. And those things will help diagnose the disease.
Now, the PSA test has been a little bit controversial periodically in terms of when somebody should start tracking that number and whether tracking it actually leads to a reduction in mortality.
Exactly. Yeah. This has been a long staying debate. It really picked up about 2-3 years ago when the U.S. Preventive Task Force put out a finding saying, or put out a paper that said that that they recommended against prostate cancer screening. And the reason they did that was because they did an analysis on the risks and benefits. And the benefit is that catching the disease early and treating it early potentially saves someone's life. Because it's a disease that you caught while it's still in the prostate. It hadn't spread from the prostate yet. And if you catch a disease while it's still in the prostate and then you treat that prostate, take it out or radiate it or do something like that, then you've made that patient cancer-free. And that cancer can't possibly come back later. But there are side effects to these treatments. And these side effects include things such as incontinence, infertility. And so it became an issue of how many men have to suffer the side effect for one man to have his life saved. And that's a very challenging, controversial topic, and that's why it's been a controversial issue on who should get prostate cancer screening.
Is it the sort of test where you sometimes get false positives and you wind up doing invasive or painful further testing on somebody who turns out not to have it?
Exactly. That's exactly the issue. So being diagnosed with prostate cancer is really a two-step process, actually. The first step is being suspected of having prostate cancer. And so that is done by the digital rectal exam if there's some abnormality like a nodule, the PSA test if it's high. If you're suspected of having cancer, then you can have a biopsy performed. And some of the newer technologies that we're working on might be that we do some imaging and some more directed biopsy. But the standard until recently has been just to get a biopsy. And then on the biopsy, one can find out whether they truly have cancer. About a third of the time the PSA test is positive, there actually is cancer. So two-thirds of the time, it's actually a false positive. What the PSA test is actually pretty good at is when the test is negative.
It's actually negative.
It's usually pretty much negative, yeah. Right. It's unusual. There's always exceptions, but usually you don't have cancer if the test says you don't have cancer. But if it says you have cancer, you have to take that with a grain of salt. And then you have to get these biopsies. And sometimes you may get diagnosed with cancer itself, actually. But the cancer may not be very aggressive. And so there may be no need to treat. But at that point, some people get so worried by the diagnosis of cancer that they just can't do something.
Yeah. Let's take a phone call. This is John in Baltimore County. John, thank you for calling. Go ahead.
Hey, hi.
Hi.
He asked me to turn my TV off here. And I think he's been addressing this situation. I won't mention the HMO I'm in, but I'm just pushing 80. And my HMO, the last time I went there, they're reluctant to give the PSA test, and they sort of even poo-pooed the digital exam. are they legally, can I tell them to do it, and they have to do it?
China, great question, and thank you so much for the phone call. I don't know about you can address the legal side, but when you get to 80, let me ask you this way. Somebody told me once that if we lived long enough as men, we'd all get this.
Yes, exactly.
Really?
This is, you know, with some exceptions, but actually they've done studies on men where they look at autopsy series. Men who are getting autopsies for any reason.
For other, right.
Accident, tragic accidents, whatever you want to say, unexplained death. And they found in those autopsy series that around the age of 80, 80% of men had some small area of cancer in their prostate. And so, really, if you look hard enough, you may find cancer.
So John's a perfect example. He's 80, sounds like he's in great shape. You know, what would your advice be in terms of, forget the HMO, if he was your patient, would you want a PSA? Would you want the digital exam?
Exactly. So, you know, this is a challenging topic, and it's very reasonable, especially men who've been very proactive about their health. They want to remain proactive about their health. The thing about prostate cancer is that even aggressive prostate cancer is slow growing. And a reasonable expectation is that if you catch it early and you did nothing about it, it would take 15 to 20 years to cause significant harm and potentially cause death. And so, you know, it becomes a little sensitive on when you stop looking for the disease, because at some point, finding it and potentially treating it is probably going to cause more harm than good.
Right. Let's talk about the treatment side a little bit. So you mentioned surgery is one option, radiation is another. What's being done in terms of deciding which way to go? Because obviously it's a dramatic operation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, generally speaking, surgery and radiation have similar effects in terms of cancer treatment efficacy, but it's depending on the individual and depending on their personal history, one treatment may be better for someone than another. If someone has a bad heart, for instance, maybe surgery is not the best option for them. Sometimes radiation might be a better option. If someone has some kind of contraindication radiation, such as previous radiation or bowel disease or something, then those patients might actually benefit from surgery. So a lot of this is actually discussion with some of the specialists who do surgery, who do radiation. And one of the main things I tell my patients, and especially patients that have questions about both, is you should really meet both providers. You should meet a radiation oncologist, you should meet a urologist, and hear from both what the benefits and cons are for each treatment. Depending on the individual, it's going to be different.
What's the future here? What are the promising areas of research?
Yeah, you know, there's so much work getting done in prostate cancer. Some of the exciting areas that are taking place is we're using more and more imaging now. So prostate cancer is really a unique organ in that every other organ, we use imaging to kind of figure out where there's cancer. So, you know, for breast, you have mammography. For brain, you have MRI. But prostate has actually been a random sampling until recently. You just get a grid-like pattern sample of the prostate because there was no good imaging for it.
In terms of where you're going for a biopsy.
Yeah, where you're going biopsy. You just
shotgun.
Sample. Yeah, and you just make sure you kind of get every area sampled nicely. And the PSA is what hinted you off that you should do a biopsy. But as advances in MRI have come along, more and more centers are actually starting to use MRI to do what's called MRI fusion biopsy. And so that's, I think, going to be an exciting area of growth. And with that, there might be many more avenues of growth, such as potentially even doing focal therapy, where you only treat the area of the prostate that has cancer and not treat the whole prostate. And maybe by doing that, we're hopeful that we'll cut down on the complications, such as incontinence, infertility, and things like that.
Let's spend a minute on some research you did on the link between people who've had vasectomies and not only prostate cancer, but a subset of prostate cancer.
Yeah,
am I right?
Exactly, yeah. So that was a big study that just came out. So before I joined the University of Maryland, I was actually up in the Harvard system. And so I joined a group up there and did this study on, it was a very big study. So 50,000 men have been followed for the last 24 years in this study called the Health Professional Follow-Up Study. And so we looked at the histories of these 50,000 men, and we divided them into two groups: men who've had a vasectomy and men who haven't had a vasectomy. And then we examined who of the men who had vasectomy had prostate cancer and aggressive prostate cancer and who didn't. And what we found was that there was a slight increase in risk of having aggressive prostate cancer in the men who had vasectomy. Now, it's a 20% increased risk, and that worries people, rightly so, but you have to take it in context that it's a rare event. And so it's actually only 16 every 1,000 men get aggressive prostate cancer, but additional 3 out of 1,000 men. So vasectomy has a lot of benefits, but the harm may not be actually.
Dr. Siddiqui, we have to leave it there. Thank you for being with us.
Great, thank you.
Your health segments are a co-production of Maryland Public Television and the University of Maryland Medical System.